Thank you. I am honored, really honored, to respond to Chaim Weinberg's rich and indeed very interesting lecture. He really deserves our admiration for having pioneered in the vast territory of the internet for group analytic reflection. He is a very fine guide to what he calls himself modern circumstances. The lecture touches on many interesting subjects, but put a particular spotlight on some basic ideas of group analysis and psychotherapy in general. Issues like boundaries, confidentiality, and privacy by exploring demonstration groups, training groups, and online groups of different sorts. The psychotherapeutic landscape has changed during the last decade. Practitioners had to move from a preference for long-term to short-term therapies in most national health systems in Europe, perhaps primarily for financial reasons, but also under the influence of academic fashions and the zeitgeist of which the internet is an important part. This development has forced us to look at what can be achieved in a shorter time and has given rise to new group forms inspired by the possibilities of virtual working and the use of the internet in daily life. The IT or internet revolution has had an enormous impact on all aspects of life and has created new forms of relating and connecting, but also of distancing and avoidance. Just think about the word friend and how it is used on Facebook, where you can have hundreds of friends. These contacts, these connections, are certainly not friends in the way I understand friends. Many of us think that the speed with which all these changes have taken place is unheard of and has never been seen before. For many people, the rapid pace of innovation is difficult to get used to, and for others, it offers a host of new possibilities. The internet is indeed impressive and also somewhat scary, with its seemingly limitless range for both good and bad usages. Seen from the positive side, you can get into contact with people on the other side of the earth in a split of a second, making networks and groups of all sorts across frontiers and cultures, and with as many as you want at the same time. You can extract loads of information when you need it and do all your shopping. The internet offers, too, the possibility of trying out different identities, playing different roles, and negotiating the passage through adolescence in a novel and creative way, albeit with the same emotional dramas. Sherry Turkle, in her book, Life on the Screen, mentions a funny cartoon from The New Yorker which illustrates these phenomena. In it, one dog, paw, 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 paw on a computer keyboard explains to another, on the internet, nobody knows you are a dog. It gives you a freedom that you don't have in real life. But it can also be a drug that you can get addicted to. You can end up living more in the virtual world than in the real life. Looked at negatively, the internet offers a forum for grooming, stalking, and a range of other abusive behaviors. A shocking example of that is Breivik, who lived his life on the internet before he killed almost 80 persons. And he is not the only one who gets inspired by the internet to commit such evil deeds. It is an important medium for crooks, fanatics, and terrorists. Another phenomenon is hate storms against individuals. The unbridled aggression against scapegoats you can witness helplessly or with pleasure on the internet is certainly an example of what Nitzan calls the anti-group. Such tendencies are inherent in any group, but in an unstructured group with no boundaries, which the internet is, it can take on an uncanny quality. This phenomenon is well described by Kernberg when he writes about the large group. It can be argued that the large group has much in common with the internet, having a weak boundary and no structure apart from time and place. Kernberg talks about an inner kernel of aggression that can break through in the large group, and which he likens to Freud's death instinct. Earl Hopper is talking about the same regressive processes in his fourth basic assumption of incohesion, aggregation, massification. There seems to be a general agreement that you cannot do real work in a large group because the aggressive pulls are too great. Other voices like Gerhard Wiege and Pat de Mare conclude, based on their experience of conducting large groups, that frustration and hate can be transformed into thinking, into forms of relating, rooted in subgroup exchanges and into a reparation process. De Mare thought of that large groups could enhance the potential of citizenship, and Wilke sees it as a container in which collective traumas and incomplete mourning processes can be worked through. This makes it understandable that online groups are able to work on deep levels. Both De Mare and Wilke show that we are not just driven mad in the large group, but also driven to relate. Our need for attachment is so strong that we always seem to compensate for the senses we cannot use. Recent research in neurobiology found that we are wired for social relationships. The discovery of mirror neurons shows the same. Our brain is social, which is not such a surprise for group analysts. One remarkable change that the internet has brought about is a change in collective attitudes towards privacy and confidentiality. We still have the secrecy of the postal service, and it remains a punishable act to open other people's letters, and it is also still perceived as a morally reprehensible act. We still have soundproof doors to our consulting rooms, in stark contrast to what people nowadays are willing to disclose about themselves on the internet. Privacy and discretion seems on its way out. The loss of privacy, I think, is the end result of a process that started in the 60s and 70s with the twin slogans that the private is public and all relationships are political. It was a protest against the traditional family, established authorities, and a narrow and paternalistic sexuality. It was also a movement towards self-realization. Christopher Lash, in his book, The Culture of Narcissism, claimed that this movement had turned, by the late 80s, into a culture of narcissism. At the time, I speculated how the children of that culture would turn out. We now know the answer. The children of the 80s became the Facebook generation, for whom privacy seems to be a foreign country. Some time ago, I was traveling by train, and in my compartment were two young women talking with one another. One of them made a phone call which lasted an hour, talking very loudly and very privately. Everybody in the compartment could hear everything, and it didn't seem to bother her in the slightest. People nowadays talk into their mobile phones as if they were alone. You could say that this is very unempathic, with no concern for other people. You can also say that they have embraced the idea that privacy is out, which seems to be part of the foundation matrix today. You could also say that we are witnessing the shadow of relating in humans, to belong and to adapt to any fashion in order to avoid becoming an outsider or object of laughter in the group, the fear of missing out. On the other hand, there is a push into the opposite direction, as we witness many attempts at protecting confidentiality and privacy by passwords and restricted websites. If we look historically at the development of connecting, we first have face-to-face contact, letter writing, phone calling, and now emails and text messages. In face-to-face contact, we can use all our senses. In writing a letter, we only have our eyes and hands. In phoning, we use our ears. And in the modern medium of emails and text messages, we are back to our sight and hands or thumbs only, but in another way before, much quicker and symbolically less elaborate. People accommodate very quickly to the conditions and possibilities that are within their reach and meet their need for connection and meaning. We are very attentive to what is not said and not written, and we look between the lines and we listen with a third ear or do other things. Haim shows in his lecture how we tend to compensate for the lack of one or two of our senses. In his lecture, he illustrates that our usual ideas about safety and confidentiality in groups are not a necessary condition for self-disclosure or deep emotional reactions. I have for some years, together with a colleague, and Linhard, who is sitting over there, conducted demonstration groups as a way of introducing people to group analysis. We have held these demonstrations at international conferences such as AGPA and IADP conferences, and for postgraduate psychologists and psychiatrists in Denmark. I can easily recognize what Haim says about these experiences. The openness and depth you can meet in such groups is surprising. People never complain about weak boundaries or a lack of confidentiality. There are, however, pitfalls, as well as you have to be extremely observant as a conductor and as a group of scapegoating tendencies or other sorts of defensive splitting, as there is not much time to repair any damage. Haim describes the same tendency for the online list he is moderating, where the boundaries are even more loose and space and time are no fixed entities. It seems we have some dogmas that are repeated from generation to generation and which you don't challenge. Tom Main has an expression for it. He calls it hierarchical promotion. By that he means that an idea that works well and belonging to the area of the ego, as he expresses it, runs the risk of being promoted to the superego and ego ideal, and therefore takes on a more dogmatic, rigid character with time and becomes something not to be questioned. Maybe this is one side of the question of boundaries. Maybe we have to be less rigid about it and try to find out under what conditions clear boundaries are a must and when they are not. This question is, in my view, implicit in this year's Fuchs lecture. The other question raised is that of confidentiality and privacy. Internet groups are challenging our usual ideas of confidentiality and privacy much more than is the case in demonstration groups. Most of us here tonight will have asked ourselves, how can we explain why these groups work? Haim mentions that the conductor's capacity for creating a safe and reflective space is paramount to make such group work. He explores the concept of secure presence, an idea rooted in attachment theory. But he says there's something else, which is the conductor's capacity to hold the group in mind. It reminds me of what the Finnish psychoanalyst Yrjö Alanen once said. When you stop thinking, Bians reverie, you can call it, of your patient, there is danger that he, she is on the way to suicide, that you have given up hope. In a transpersonal way, the patient knows. There is a difference in the way the conductor is seen in the large group and the way she or he is seen in an internet group. The large group on the internet and the internet group have weak boundaries and minimal structure in common, but the internet groups more so. This difference manifests itself in the transference to the conductor. In the large group, the frustration gives rise to much aggression toward the leader that is contrary to what happens in online groups with even weaker boundaries, where there is a strong tendency to idealize the conductor. Such virtual groups have a bigger need to keep the conductor safe in a more unsafe situation. This is the basic assumption of dependency, to use Bian's language. This, of course, means that there are limits to what can be obtained in such groups. Fuchs once said that idealization of the conductor is one of the strongest resistances, but sometimes it is necessary in order to survive. I come to think of the large group and Linhard and I had just conducted at the AGPA conference in New York this year. The participants didn't show much aggression. Perhaps one reason was that one of the conductors had lost her voice and had to use a microphone. and obviously also had a severe cold. It probably was important for the group to cure her and not to kill her. The participants of these groups, just as the conductors, also hold to the unconscious fantasy of the invisible group, as Weinberg mentions. This is, in my opinion, made possible by the common ground of the matrix being shared and experienced as a safety net of social relationships. We have yet to understand how much ahead of his time Fuchs really was. His concept of the matrix and the transpersonal processes is indeed groundbreaking and original. Many others have contributed to the understanding of these processes, as Heim mentions, and Fuchs himself, of course, stands on the shoulders of Freud, Goldstein, Elias, and Levine. Let me quote what he said about Levine. For our orientation to the hospital therapeutic community at Northfield, we found that our group analytic view married well with concepts used in field theory, and that the latter helped us in our orientation. Here belongs, for instance, the concept of the social field. Further, there is common background as regards Gestalt psychology. Fuchs had the capacity to put these different inspirations into that one concept, the matrix. He has different versions of definitions of the concept. The ones I think fits the present subject is the following. The network of all mental processes, the psychological medium in which they meet, communicate, and interact can be called the matrix. In further formulation of our observations, we have to come to conceive these processes not merely as interpersonal, but as transpersonal. And further, the healthy organism functions as a whole and can be described as a system in dynamic equilibrium, has constantly to adjust, there's always a creative element present, acts as if it knew its aim and had a choice as to the means to achieve this aim. To take into account all these factors, we speak of the total situation. The last citation is taken from Powell's seminal article, Matrix, Mind and Matter. And the next step is, of course, the group as a whole. What I think here is the key to understanding what we are talking about is the concept of the total situation. The matrix encompasses the nature of the transpersonal mind, and the transpersonal mind has no boundaries. This is the total situation. The matrix is not based on the existence of physical boundaries or even bodies. The total situation encompasses these special sorts of groups. The matrix is active in us. My example from Uri Allen shows it, and you certainly all have had the almost uncanny experience of coming back to a therapy, individual or group, as if the person of the group had been at the supervision. You don't have to do anything. The field has already changed. So I conclude by saying that impossible groups don't challenge group analysis as much as group analysis challenges us.